They're trying to tell us something. They have figured out the formula for chaos.
When the clock strikes 8:30, babe, time to head for Chris's house.
Hey.
Will the sun make it to the next round?
Oh no.
Pot of thunder. Let's pot tonight. Come on, baby, let's pot tonight.
Yep. We did it already. I can feel it. It's not too early to celebrate.
Another good one in the bag. But let's do it. Here we go. Oh, yeah. Welcome to Pot of Thunder, the recognized symbol of excellence in rock and roll podcasting, brought to you by Blue Microphones. They look great. They sound even better. And you know me.
Shoot it, D. He's a creep. Lay down with Andy and the price is steep because he shoots it deep. He's a creep. He's got his swans at the ready, run you over like a jeep. Yeah.
Another Chris L. lead vocal. Love it.
They're just getting better.
They are. Yeah. Well, you know me. It's your buddy Andy, America's little brother.
Shooting it deep.
Shooting it deep week after week. And as always, joined by a man over there
getting into his costume. Buffalo Bill costume.
Will today be the
tuck day? Tuck his penis between his legs and approach the camera.
Will today be the day when shit goes flying? Let's find out. Polka dancing his way across the podcast studio.
Watch the cord. Watch the cord.
Yes. Nick Polak has joined the program. Good evening, young ladies. Good evening, young gentlemen. Nick is here. He's disrobing, and he's back with us now.
Yeah, that display right there is worth the price of admission.
It
on
is.
Its own.
Yeah, it is.
That's a good-looking zip-up you've got on tonight.
Oh, thank you.
Nice color on you, the purple.
Nice.
Thank you.
Is it purple?
It's like a maroon. But
let's go with Merlot. I'm going to call that a nice, or Cabernet it. Be a nice color description for that. Is that hooded? I don't have my glasses on.
Yeah.
Me no see so good.
Is that also from the Blake Shelton collection?
I think this is Old Navy. I don't remember.
Well, it could
be nice
both.
Piece, yeah. You never know who's aligned in the fashion world.
Yeah.
Old Navy is definitely Blake Shelton speed.
Yeah, that would work. Oh, man. So Nick's here. And two Knicks left. You want them. We got them.
I can have it every day. Yeah, yeah. I can have it. Get out of my way. Yeah, fuck you.
Yes, put your hands together for the breakout star of the podcast, Medium. That is Chris L. We are Pot of Thunder. Oh, episode 506 goes down in history as one of my all-time favorites. Again, looking at the notes in advance. Reading the script at the table read earlier today. Oh, yeah. The writers put together a dynamite episode for you. Breaking down one of your very favorite songs of all time. Wonderful Yardo questions. Oh, so funny. I couldn't believe them. Thought-provoking. Humorous. Even a little bit emotional at times.
Wow.
All the elements of a great podcast. Even there's some of that... Some of that true crime in there that people like.
Plenty
of mystery.
That.
Oh.
Yeah, that's why the avalanche of cash has begun for us, the true crime element.
Yeah.
Just the case of the Chupaga Bandit will be this week.
There you go.
True crime makes cocks and credit cards burst out of pants and not necessarily in that order.
I don't know why, but it's true. People love it.
People love it. They pay whatever the price is, they'll pay double for it.
I hate it.
I don't consume any of it.
I turn it off if it's on. I don't care for it. And these, bums me out.
These people who consume this stuff are the same people who just will, to anybody who will listen, express their complete bewilderment at all these mass shootings and other grisly crimes that happen
from coast to coast. How could this happen? Gee, I wonder.
You're saying we're a culture obsessed with murder?
You could say that.
Yeah.
Could certainly say that.
Yeah. Well, we're going to insert some murder and true crime into this episode, as we said.
Maybe the song will be about that.
That's what the people want. That's what they're getting.
Are there any good murder songs we haven't done yet?
I guess a lot of body count songs that we haven't done yet.
Mind of a Lunatic we haven't done. That would be a good one.
Yeah.
That's I can't think of a better one, to be honest with you. That one's about as good as it gets.
Psychotic. Well, we'll see what we get today.
For all you sickos out there.
Sick freaks. It's probably on the list. We'll see. Nick, open the treats. Let's go.
Let's see stuff tonight?
Let's see it.
We will next week.
What?
Son of a
bitch. We will next week. I don't have anything this
week. I'll be damned. I'm going to sit here with water.
These Andy theme songs have been taking all my kitchen time.
We're going to have abs if you keep going with these Andy theme songs instead of treats.
You know, summer's going to be here before we know it.
Got to get our beach bodies in order.
Are you going to go for it this year? Are you going for it?
I'm going for it.
It's already too late when you think about it.
I was going to say, you've had to make that decision already. You're at the very tail end of being able to pull it off.
It's already too late. Planned for 2024 at this point.
Yeah.
But it is Pot of Thunder month, so...
Thank goodness.
Well,
you don't need a beach body to enjoy this, fortunately. Otherwise, none of us would enjoy it ever.
Are you suggesting that none of us have beach bodies?
I am suggesting that, yes.
That's true. Well, it's Pot of Thunder month. And bang. Yes. That's how I feel when I look at myself in the mirror.
Well, especially now that you're in your 40s.
I take my shirt off and I go, isn't it? And put my shirt back on.
Yeah. Yep.
Get in the pool with my shirt on.
Yeah. That's when you're broadcasting to the world that your self-esteem is less than zero.
When you wear the shirt in the pool?
When you have the shirt on in the pool.
Yeah. Yeah.
That's just not good.
It's not good. You don't want to do that.
No.
No.
Just don't get in the pool if you're not prepared to take your shirt off. That's just how it is.
The alternative at this point is getting unnaturally tan. So if you're not going to get the beach bod, you should at least get the color.
Yeah, you do need that.
Yeah, it's got to be one or the other, if not both. But at this point, you need to do some extreme tanning, maybe some manscaping. Nick, maybe you could do like...
I'm out.
Maybe you could do manscaping of like a high-waisted thong. Like the Paul Stanley Crazy Nights thong, but made of body hair. Coming over his...
of body hair in that area. That would be easier for Nick to carve out a thong.
That's what I mean, yeah.
Yeah, just do the side straps over your hip pointers. You don't actually have to cut into the forest that exists in your actual nether region, but do the peekaboo straps over the hip pointers.
There you
go. Be good.
It'll just look like two St. Louis arches on either side of you.
Exactly.
That'll be perfect.
I'll look like a big LA Rams helmet walking around.
Yeah, there perfect. You go.
How odd would that be? People would be so befuddled by that choice of body grooming.
Inspired by Paul Stanley. A pioneer in that field.
I think he should do it.
Maybe even do some body paint and teal on that spot after you cut it out.
If you really wanted to get elaborate with it, you could go to a professional, have them carve out in the front Everlast. Just have it, you know, right over the honey pot, so to speak, and have that on display. That would be good.
Between the belly button. And
Can you imagine going to a place and asking for that to be done?
A rectangle and then Everlast.
I would have guessed that more often than not, you'd be directed to the door, shown the door.
Yeah.
Asked or forcibly told to get out.
You mentioned that professionals would have to be brought in. Are there professionals in such a field?
Well, they carve out all these designs in people's heads with the hair. With
that's
the
true.
Hair
I could probably head over to the barbershop in Meyer and they'll take care of that.
Yeah.
Is that what they got going on over there?
Yeah, I think so.
Okay. All right. In Meyer.
Gotta go to Meyer.
Yeah, the local superstore. Get your groceries, lottery tickets.
Pretzel store still open in that lobby.
Yeah.
There you go.
Yes, it is.
Get a pretzel. Get your pube shaved and do a
buttery pretzel. You know, something gut folding over the Everlast logo. You just had carved in your lower abdomen.
Yeah. One stop pre Memorial Day shop.
Yeah, that's true.
Yeah, they've got everything you need over there.
Dads and grad sale on pube trimming. We talked about that before. That's Paul Stanley has gotten the ab shaved in.
Yeah,
into his body hair before.
Which is
absurd. So someone had to do that. You think he did that himself?
He might have.
I mean, he's an artist.
They
maybe.
Do their own makeup, allegedly, every night.
Do they trim their own pubes? Or is there a guy for that?
There's a good chance.
Good chance, and also Paul Stanley asking for it is a little different from Nick asking for it. Someone would agree to do it more readily to Paul Stanley, I think.
Okay. Well, either way, Ace, I think he outed me and Paul for doing that earlier today. I'm not sure what happened, but
was it eventful?
I have no idea.
Yeah.
Just in case people are, are
garbage.
Not aware.
This nothing was, happened. The threat wasn't followed through on, which shouldn't shock anybody.
No.
Yeah.
You know, anybody who tuned into that, arranged their day around listening to that, is a complete jackass.
You got suckered.
Yeah.
You fell for it.
Well,
you took the bait.
These are the same people who think the final shows will be at Madison Square Garden on the first couple days of December, and they're going to pay top dollar for that. And then in about 6 months, there's going to be more shows announced.
Yeah.
It'll be the same shit that the Motley Crue did.
Yeah. It's just going to go until they're physically unable to perform due to death. That's got to be it. That'll do it. All right. Well, hey.
It's your turn.
It's my turn, but you know what? It's been 10 years, hasn't it?
Yeah.
Is that right?
True.
You have a salutation in there.
I do. This one came to us from Gary Branville. Bob strikes 10, must be Monday night. A decade of stupidity, but that's all right. Listen to Pound of Thunder tonight. Leave us a voice message tonight.
Andy, Nick, and Chris. Congrats on 10 years. It's been a hell of a run. I just want to say thank you guys for all the entertainment and all the laughs that you've given me. I'm the third of four brothers, the oldest being about Chris's age, and I'm about Andy's age. So it really feels like I'm just sitting around and listening to my brother's BS, and we're into all the same stuff. Kiss is what got me into this show. My older brothers got me into Kiss, and it's just been really great to listen to and share those moments with you. Some memorable moments from the show for me were the Caribbean Cove episodes, which just pure gold. Can't even make it up. And then Andy breaking my heart at the end of the 2000 Man episode. So
still
painful.
Controversial.
And Chris expanding my vocabulary. I use hirsute in every opportunity I get.
Appropriate. So, yeah, that fits in with
thank
the
you guys. I appreciate everything you guys do, and for free for the most part. And let's make it another 10 years. Love you guys.
Oh, another.
What are you doing to us?
Death sentence? What do we kiss?
this is the farewell year, by the way.
Hey, you never know. It is what it is. We're here right now. We're here till we're not. We're here right now. We're going to have a good time. Thank you, Gary.
When you think about it, all of us are, in one way or another, marching toward the end. So, you know, you can frame it that way.
Of course. Yeah.
Yeah.
Some faster than others.
Some slower than others would like, but yeah.
Refer back to about 5 minutes ago. Ace Frehley.
No, oh, that was well.
Not saying I wish he died.
No,
but that's kind of what I said. It would be more dignified if he would have kicked the bucket many years ago before he could humiliate himself in front of his entire fan base.
Just today?
Well,
today is the thing that did it?
No, I know. It's been years.
He's had some moments.
He's an idiot. I mean, basically, everything he's done, every single thing he's done in the last, what, at least 15 years, 10 years? I'll say 10 for sure.
Yeah.
I'll give him Spaceman. Up to Spaceman. That was his redemption. And then he's, so that was what, 09. So it was 13 and a half years ago. The last 13 and a half years, he's shit all over his legacy. He should have put that CD out and tossed himself off a cliff.
Wow.
It's hard to argue with that unless you're just a straight up Ace apologist. I mean, it's just what's happened is embarrassing, and we should probably just not dignify it with any further discussion. But so it's whose turn is it?
It's
you?
My turn. Okay. Oh, it's gonna get ugly.
So I would say if I can just give you a bit of a cautionary tale before you dive into it, I would say. Look at who submitted the song as well, in addition to what the song is. I'll be doing that moving forward. I'm use that to help me make my decisions, specifically which songs to reject.
May I ask why? What's your thinking behind this?
Just, you know, want to make sure this thing, especially now that some people are paying for it, doesn't go down an unsavory road.
Okay, so, that's fair.
Just planting that seed. If you're on the fence, look at, you know, who submitted it and or the comments, which we've always looked at the comments to kind of sway us, but
yeah,
you know, we do have a smaller pool of people submitting songs, and I just think in general we shouldn't let any single person or a small faction take it over. Mm-hmm. Just in general. So,
all right, I'm with you. I think that's fair to consider.
Just putting that out there. Do with it what you will.
All right.
How has the list grown since the last time?
I don't remember. I think it was 500 something last time. It's 623 now.
That's so good. That's a good clip.
Yeah.
Yeah.
It's growing. So, Nick, I'm going to need you to take that caboozy and pull
We're getting closer.
The lever. Make it happen, Nick. I always forget that the Bozo Pewter is significantly longer than the sports machine. So I have to be on top of my game to get this all set up in time.
We're always pushing ourselves.
Yeah, I've got number 170.
Okay.
Submitted by a non-horse's ass.
Good. That's progress.
I'm going to put this in the hopper, and I'll tell you why without telling you what it is. It's solid. It's good stuff.
It's not... blowing your skirt up in a irresistible way.
I don't know how... It might. Let's see. I was going to say, I don't know how much we can mine from it other than high-fiving each other and saying it's cool. But
we always find something to talk about.
All right. Let's see. Let's give it another pull. Nick?
Wow, that was quick.
That was quick. How come I didn't hear that before?
Because we didn't go to another song.
We didn't do it last week. Huh?
It was the first pull last week. Yeah,
it was an instant yes because I knew Nick liked the song and I did too. So
okay, we're not doing that. One more, Nick. One more.
What number was that?
583.
Okay.
583. That was 583. And here we go. Last one here. Dum dum dum. This is my last choice. We got to go with the Chris Brown rule. You know, everyone knows the Chris Brown rule. If a woman finds your phone and sees a message from another, no, that's not it.
Oh my goodness,
that's the wrong Chris Brown. Abort.
Is that what happened?
I think.
How do you know so much of that story?
That was I had my finger on the pulse back then.
I guess
hey, he's up to date on pop culture.
I mean, that is like a 20-year-old story, but yeah.
So what number are you looking at now?
573. That's my last one here.
573, okay.
Oh, get out of here. We're going with the first one. Going with the first one.
First one.
Hold on, let me see if I can find anything here.
Yeah, while you do that.
I do. Hit it!
Wow, that was quick.
Abemus Papa.
Time for Pope stuff. Ain't that Pope stuff? Here's some Pope stuff.
The double tracking makes it.
Yeah. Just getting further and further away from each other.
So, I don't know if you want to chime in with your other feature that you introduced last week.
No, that could just be a backup.
Okay. Well, I struck gold with the year 573, Andy's third poll, which he bushwhacked almost instantly.
Yeah.
But yeah, I Google the year 573. The Wikipedia entry always comes up at the top, and then I scroll down under events, and I'm looking for by topic religion, and bam, got a single bullet point here that's just right in line with what we need. Y'all ready?
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
Okay, 573. Any guesses, Nick, on who the Pope was?
I don't know. It's probably too early for a Boniface, but I'll say Boniface.
That would not be correct, yeah. But good guess. Better than what I would come up with. Okay, so here we go. Pope John III.
Oh, okay.
Is forced by the Lombards to retire from Rome and takes up residence at the catacombs along the Via Appia.
Forced to retire.
Forced to. Who the fuck are the Lombards who have this sort of clout that they can force a pope to retire?
I don't know.
Very interesting.
There's a lot of mafioso type stuff.
Really?
Families lobbying for power over other families, and the papacy was in the middle of it, it seems, a lot of times. Yeah, there was a lot of rival families.
I was going to say, anytime there's some kind of power at that level, there's going to be backdoor deals and backstabbing.
Even right? Way back then? When?
Oh, come on.
Yeah.
Forever.
All right, I'll take your word for it. But there you go. Forced to retire, John III. Get out. The directive was clear. You're done. Get out.
Buzz off. All right. That's it. That was it, though. It just said forced to retire. It didn't say forced to retire by blank.
That's all the information.
Yeah.
I wonder how often that even happened. Usually it's, till they expire.
Or I was going to say like an assassination or something.
Yeah, or either a natural death or an unnatural one.
And how do you force somebody to retire?
Maybe you say, if you don't retire, we're going to kill you. All right, I'm out.
that would be one way to go about it.
Yeah. All right, I'll see you guys. I'm done poping. How many popes have been assassinated? A lot? I don't know.
Yeah, I think so.
Back in the day?
Yeah. Really?
Yeah, wow. And they're even... I'm not one to... perpetuate a conspiracy theory, but
here we go.
Oh, let's see if I can tie it back to season one of this podcast. There, I don't remember who the last pope was, but there was a pope we never got to see.
Uh huh.
He became pope, and then the pope died.
Yep.
That was Pope John Paul I in 1978. He was pope for a month.
He got assassinated?
Well,
oh, you're saying maybe
he
conspiracy.
Was talking about cleaning up. Getting to the bottom of like all the Vatican banking stuff going on.
Yeah, that was a bad move.
And the one of the theories, it's never been proven. I don't think they did an autopsy, which lends more fuel to that fire.
They put him in the bottom of a lake.
That's some tea. He had some tea one night, and then Someone served him a cup of tea, and the next morning...
Whoever
it was.
Some random guy served him a cup of tea.
And he said, yeah, I'll take that. Give me that tea. Well, I know tensions are high. I'll take this tea from a stranger.
Lesson learned. And look, I've done some crazy shit in my day. Some shit that probably should have killed me. Even I'm not crazy enough to be like, you know what? I'm going to try and clean up the Vatican banking. That's what I'm going to do.
Yeah,
what could possibly go wrong there?
Things seem to go wrong when someone has that as their mission.
Mm-hmm. Well, are things going to go right here?
What do you think,
Song?
Well, I mean, he seems to indicate there will be high fives going around and will like it. So that's
seems
a good thing.
Pretty collected, though.
Yeah, I think so.
He's not.
You know, in his old age, he's become a little more dignified. Okay. He's not the, you know, just complete jackass he used to be.
He's the Just for Men version of Andy.
He is.
It's true in many ways. Yeah, okay.
He's using Just for Men on his ear hair. Now. God.
If I'm not groomed as well as I used to be, it's because I spend all my grooming time making sure I don't have any ear hair. That's the one thing I'm trying to keep under wraps at this point.
I'm having to address the ear hair like twice weekly at this point.
Can't have it.
Shocking. Yeah. No, that... You need the implement, the tool, whatever it is, to get in there and take care of it. I mean, Nick letting his ball hair grow wildly, that's a personal choice. You gotta chop down the ear hair and the nose hair as well.
Yeah, you can't have that stuff sticking out.
You can't, no.
Mm-mm. No. All right.
Oh, man.
Well... If you've got it sticking out right now, get it taken care of.
When it gets to the point where you can carve Paul Stanley thong straps in your ear hair, yeah, you got a lot of ear hair. Get rid of it all.
This episode is less a rock and roll podcast and more a retiree breakfast club over at McDonald's.
But it's true.
They need this help.
Yeah, and we're 10 years in. This is what we talk about.
Yeah. You know? You ever see a woman with long nose hair, like sticking out of the nose?
Not for very long, I'll tell you that.
Yeah, she saw your back walking away quickly.
Yeah, that you can't have it. It just can't be.
I remember I worked with a woman young, you know, this was in my 20s, worked with a same age woman who had dark black nose hairs protruding out of the nose. No. And I was just like, come on, man.
You never noticed it. I'm talking about the woman.
Yeah.
She had to have known that it was there.
And it's something you can help. I'm not picking on someone for something they can't help. You can trim your nose hair sticks out of your
Especially
nose.
Especially now, I mean, they make all, you know, there's a variety of tools and trimmers that you can use specifically for that purpose.
Yeah, and these were thick ones too. It was disturbing. You could have stringed up a tennis racket with these things. It's a nightmare.
What a shame.
All right.
And how
Uncle Pecos came by needing a guitar string.
Boing.
I mean, it was not your place to do it, but somebody in her life needed to step in and say, look, parent, you know, mother figure, mentor, whatever. Someone needed to step up and say, look, this, you need to take care of this.
Yeah, no kidding. I should have just gone at her with some scissors one day.
There's your true crime angle.
Yeah.
He disliked it so much he killed her.
Yeah. I didn't mean I was going to kill her. I mean, I was going to cut them for her.
Well, I mean, we just lost listeners.
So
they thought you killed her.
And I accidentally killed her. It was terrible. Anyway. Yeah. Okay. Let's turn the microphone over to Chris Jericho.
All right, Harold. This one's called
Get the Funk Out.
Ooh. Off of
Extreme 2 Porno Graffiti.
By the band
Extreme.
All right, this rectifies a years-long blemish that we've had.
as far as the one extreme song that we did.
Yeah, which we, none of us were particularly thrilled with.
What was it called? Big Boys Don't Cry?
I think so, Boys Don't Cry or something? Something like
maybe.
That's one of the two. Neither is acceptable.
Yeah, okay.
But this is the first extreme song I think I ever heard.
Really?
I think so. I think I saw this video. I don't know if it was Headbangers Ball or some other place. I think they played Extreme on Headbangers Ball sometimes.
You would have heard this before you heard Play With Me from Bill and Ted's? Wasn't that on the first album?
Ooh.
Or was that on this album?
I don't know.
I think that's on the
maybe,
first, but
maybe
I'm
you're
also
right.
Very stupid, so it might be.
No, on. No, you might be on the ball there. Well, maybe this is the first one that I remember knowing the band's name.
Instead of just hearing it.
If I heard it in the movie at that age, I would have had no idea. I would have just known the song.
Yeah, I didn't know.
But
who
knowing
it was.
That this was a band called Extreme, this was the first song I remember.
Yeah. Play With Me is on the first album, 1989. Okay. This is Hell If I Know. I can't figure out what year it is. Whatever. Some other year.
So who submitted this one?
Some dickhead.
Wow.
Sorry, I'm irritated because I'm trying to find what year the second one is, but it's that thing where they re-release it in 2015. So it's, Extreme 2 is 2015, according to them. Anyway, I'm sorry, you're not a dickhead. This one was submitted by... Oh, Jeremy Patterson. Definitely not a
definitely
dickhead.
Not.
Good guy, Jeremy Patterson.
1990, by the way.
Okay, so the very next year. All right, so Jeremy has something to say here. He says, these guys unfortunately wrote a very good bet. Wait, is that right? Hold on. A ballad? Is that the right comment? It is. All right, let's see what you have to say. Okay. Oh, he's just talking. Okay.
Yeah.
All right. These guys unfortunately wrote a very good ballad at a time when that was what everyone wanted. Made them a lot of money, but most people forget that they had an entire catalog 100 times better than the hit. Also, they got a pretty rough representation so far on the show. They deserve redemption. Well, I hope we get that today, Jeremy. Thank you for your comment. Thank you for submitting this.
And, of course, they've just recently come out with a new song. I believe it's called Rise. It's gotten a lot of attention in guitar nerd circles for the solo, and much discussion has happened about that. So
people popping their corks over that one.
Extreme is back in the discussion, at least among music and or guitar nerds.
Is that album out, or is it just a single?
I don't know. I've not seen or heard any other songs come out from it, so I do not know.
Well, I can tell you now that I looked. Coming June 9th, 12 songs. The album is called Six.
Okay.
There you go.
This album's pretty stacked. This Extreme 2. Yeah, I'm just looking at the track listing here.
Mm-hmm.
Some great ones on there.
I think I mentioned this before, but the store manager at the Guitar Center I worked at when I first arrived in Chicago was a huge Extreme fan, so listened at his behest a lot of Extreme in the store after work, hanging out with him. You know, he always had Extreme playing, and the thing I noticed the most was how well produced the material was, especially this second album, and then the Three Sides Every Story one. It was along the lines of the Living Color album, where the production just jumped out at me as being like beyond what a lot of other bands were doing at the time.
Seems like a very appropriate band to be played in Guitar Center.
Yeah, well, since the guy who ran the store was an Extreme fan, he had a fair amount of it playing at certain opportunities.
Nick, what are your thoughts on Extreme? You said this album looks stacked.
I don't own this album, but I've heard many of the songs off of it, and I'm pretty sure I'm right here. It's got a song that's very like kind of old school ballad, like not a rock band ballad, but like an older sort of ballad. When I First Kissed You, am I wrong? I think that
song's on here, but I don't know.
I think it's that one. It's a pretty cool departure. They're a band who will do that from time to time.
They do what they want, right?
Which, I mean, it says it all, really. That who kind of stole the show at the Freddie Mercury tribute show. Extreme kind of did. Yeah. I won't say they completely did, because I know George Michael is probably the big one that people point to from that. Mm-hmm. But, I mean, everybody was playing Extreme songs, but that medley that they pulled off was pretty incredible.
Yeah, you gotta tip your hat to them.
I mean, they're a band that... Yeah, they're like in that lineage stemming from Queen, with the adventurous sort of sounds and arrangements and a lot of like the tongue in cheek kind of silly lyrical content from time to time. Very appropriate.
Okay. Are you guys ready to dive into this one?
Yes.
Any other thoughts before we do it?
There's a lot of horns on this one too.
Oh, that's
aren't
right.
There?
Yeah.
It's when I remember a horn arrangement. We like our horns on this show.
Yeah, they were not afraid of horns, huh? Did they tour with horns?
That I don't know. Hmm. Back in the day. Somewhat recently, I've seen, you know, some of their stuff, and they've seen no visible horns on stage. But
I would almost think there'd be like a keyboardist doing all that, but I have no clue.
Maybe they do the tracks thing and have horns. I don't know. I know that people weren't really doing it as much back then, but now it seems the way to go. I don't know. But is there anything we need to know? Personnel, are we good? We'll figure it out as we go.
Yeah, I think I mean, certainly Gary Cherone and Nuno Betancourt are the...
Yeah.
Steven Tyler and Joe Perry of Extreme, Mick and Keith of Extreme.
And the bass player gets name dropped in the song, so we'll learn his name too.
Okay, I did not know that.
These guys are from Boston, huh?
Yeah.
In my mind, I just assumed they were a California, Southern California band, but...
Nope.
Boston guys, eh? Okay.
Clearly had larger penises than the Dropkick Murphys, because they're not as angry and they're not as shitty as Dropkick Murphys. So a little more well-endowed, which you would expect from, you know, the likes of Cherone and Betancourt. Easy on the eyes, especially Nuno. The guy's a complete package, just a monster guitar player and...
Great singer, great harmony.
Is he a good singer?
Yeah. He's like Chris said, he really is like the total package. And like someone engineered him in a lab.
Visually a stunning individual. And as some people may or may not know, but he's been in Rihanna's band for the past several years, her live band. I don't know if he's doing any work with her in the studio, but he was on stage at the Super Bowl halftime show this year and has appeared with her on Saturday Night Live, and I think has toured with her extensively. So that's pretty cool. It's a nice paycheck for him, I'm sure, and to stay relevant, even though not many people probably pay attention to Rihanna's backing band, but anybody who's grown up on the kind of music we listen to, he instantly, again, just he's visually a striking guy. You just say, "Holy shit, is that Nuno and Rihanna's band?"
Just,
and then
recognize him right away.
Yeah, and then you just realize that he's been that guy for her for a long time.
He's the male Orianthe, if you will.
Yes.
A good way to put it, but yes.
Is that the correct way of saying her name? I don't even know.
No clue.
Yeah, you see her pop up once in a while. Like, she might be, is she at that Hobart Theater too?
Yeah. Okay. She's supposed to be here pretty soon.
Yeah, she's been
playing
with Winger at some outdoor festival in Portage coming up.
She's playing there too?
Yeah, I think
She's gone native.
Does she live here?
And jeez, I believe she's moved on from Richie Sambora and is now dating Tracy Guns of L.A. Guns.
Oh, wow.
Just making the rounds of all the 80s guitar players. So maybe Nuno's on the list.
Maybe Michelangelo Baddio is not far away, I'm thinking, in her future.
He probably shot her down. He's too busy.
He's probably perfecting his craft.
Yeah.
Yeah, he's too busy practicing. Oh.
But imagine what he could do with both hands simultaneously.
Just straight up kill a woman, probably.
All right, let's get into...
Is there a true crime again?
There it is.
As he just continues to headbang for an hour and a half.
Mm-hmm, mm-hmm.
A warm human woman becomes a hot human woman in the both hands of Michelangelo Badio.
All right. Let's take a quick commercial break. We'll be right back with Get the Funk Out.
Chris said great production. Mm-hmm. Everything is, I mean, you can hear everything perfectly so far as
well,
every drum.
There's going on.
The sound of everything, but it's big, mm-hmm. even though we just have drums and bass right now.
Yeah.
It's big.
It's dance music.
Thumping stuff, yeah.
Well, yeah, and it's, you know, one of the things that bands used to do, and like even on our low level, we tried it because we read that bands were doing this, was that you would mix down in the studio, and then you'd transfer the mix to a cassette. You'd go out to the parking lot in somebody's car and put it in the car stereo. And it's like, if it sounds good in a car system, you've nailed it. Mm-hmm. And I just remember, like, after work at Guitar Center, we would retire out to the parking lot behind the store, which was in Wrigleyville, Chicago, so it was basically like an alley and just like a little few parking spaces that probably go for, you know, $2,000 a month now or some shit like that. Mm-hmm. And we would just hang out after work, and people would crank up the car stereos just parked, and we'd jam out to music, and this was one of them. And I was just like, hearing it in a car stereo is when I was like, wow, this sounds great. You know?
Okay.
I won't say it's on this level, but it reminded me of when I heard the first Boston album way in the mid-70s. And I was probably 9 or 10. Well, I had to have been 9 when it came out, but, and I didn't know anything about production or any of the stuff related to that aspect of the music. I just remember hearing that and just, you know, after hearing other albums and in the older brothers' collections and being like, sound like a blanket had been lifted off the stereo speakers. And it's like the production was just so far beyond what everybody else was doing. You could just hear it instantly. Mm-hmm. This reminds me of that. The drum, the snare drum, I could use a little more crack to it. It still has that 80s. It's like down-tuned, full-sounding snare, but it's not as terrible as most other like 80s hair bands were putting out back in the day. It's kind of in the middle there. It's definitely not Living Color Vivid quality, but it's better than most of their peers were putting out at the time.
Well, and it's interesting you bring up Living Color, because I think they really, that's the other band that I could think of that was big at the time that was doing a similar type thing that Extreme was doing, where it was really heavy, really melodic, but there was a lot of funk in it.
Mm-hmm.
And shred guitar players.
Yeah.
It's just something that at that time was like, and I mentioned this before on the show, but I'll say it again. It in hearing the original STP, like Mighty Joe Young demos,
yeah,
they clearly were influenced by this sort of thing that was going on musically, mm-hmm. like around the time that like the Living Color Vivid album came out. So I don't know what that genre would be referred to, but I'd say these are the two biggest bands that I could think of who were doing that and captured that sound that time period.
Yeah.
The other band that was going on around that time and venturing into in obscuria territory here, but the other band, much lesser known, but was definitely in this wheelhouse, was Dan Reed Network. And that's another album that came across the entertainment desk at the college newspaper, and I snatched it up and listened to it, and I thought it was really good. And again, it was just, the production was outstanding.
Terrible name.
Dan Reed Network.
One of the very worst names I've ever heard. Just the most. I'm not saying anything bad about the band, but I'm just saying upon hearing that, that's an instant pass it by on the record store.
It's not something that you want to look into.
Unless the cover of the album is incredible, that's not something I'm looking at. Unless someone gives me a recommendation, but what I mean? It's just Dan Reed Network.
Yeah.
No, thank
That's
you.
That's true. Not terribly intriguing.
Yeah, that makes sense. I mean, Dan Reed is not exactly a striking name, and then you throw on Network.
It's garbage. That's probably why that's why you said, you know, there's the two big ones and the obscure one. If he had a better name for his band,
could be.
He'd be in the top three.
You never know.
Yeah.
Well, here's another one for you. So another band, lesser known band from the 80s, who's kind of in this wheelhouse, but actually ventured more into what Primus was doing, and I saw them open up for Living Color once in a smaller club when Living Color was headlining. What do you think of this name? Royal Crescent Mob.
Not great either.
Not great either. Okay.
I like Royal Crescent. I don't know. Mob.
The man is particular about his band names. You can't fault him for that.
I mean, it's not as boring. Maybe I would at least look at it and see, hey, what's going on with this? And then, again, make a decision based on song titles or album title or album cover. But doesn't grab me. Are you into that name?
Yeah, I thought it was okay. I mean, they were really good and different, and they kind of like were a precursor to Primus. They had this kind of this weird quirkiness both to the music and the visual presentation. But I don't know, I just wanted to get your thoughts on that. If you pulled out like the rather common name of Dan Reed, I mean, that's, you know, that's not really very compelling, but the music was great, and it you know, was in this wheelhouse and sort of came out around 87, 88, so I think, I wonder, okay. I'd be curious to know how, because I don't know this offhand, how much Extreme was influenced by bands like that.
Yeah, I never heard of them. I'll have to check them out. Curious, because if you said it's like a precursor to Primus, I'd like to hear what was
you
going
would
on.
Like Royal Crescent Mob more than Dan okay. Reed Network, given your musical taste.
Interesting. Okay. I hope we get a Primus song at some point. I can't believe that hasn't happened yet.
Yeah, I would be into that too, way into that.
Yeah.
That was another one where, you know, first saw the video on Headbangers Ball. Johnny was a race car driver. Instantly
Jerry.
Hooked. Or yeah. Jerry. Yeah. Yeah.
It's our dad's name, so I can't forget it.
Yeah, there you go. Instantly hooked, though. It was like, wow, this is another one of those, like, along the lines of the Jane's Addiction thing, we're like, okay, this is totally different.
Yeah.
Against the grain, and it's awesome.
Mm-hmm.
And it's when something that different comes on your radar that way, you gotta take notice of it.
Yeah.
It's like, how did they cut through all the crap and get to this level when really music that's that different is rarely celebrated and promoted? Mm-hmm. So that's impressive on its own.
Yeah, it is. You know, you mentioned that thing about playing the mix of your own band in the car. When Nick and I had a band, I remember he did something similar. Nick was like the producer, and he's like, here, go take this tape and go in the car. And I went in the car, and the tape was blank, and I thought, we haven't even started recording yet. And he locked the door to the studio, and then he tossed a bag of Fritos out.
There you go.
The album got made.
See, now that's a good producer. That's what Bo Hill would have done to Warren DeMartini if he wasn't cutting it.
Nick gave me a tape and said, go listen to it, and I realized I rode my bicycle to the studio that day.
Crafty move by a seasoned producer to get the bullshit out of the studio. Actually get some work done.
Okay. All right. I can't stretch it any longer.
forgot about what this song was about. I enjoy it quite a bit.
What's the first thing you said?
If you don't like what you see here, nobody's trying to take you prisoner.
Okay.
Lashing out at the audience right away.
This could be Conversations of Pope John number one.
Was he one?
Was that right?
Three. Oh, you mean
One who we Pope talked John. About who got forced to retire.
True.
Getting all defiant with the... Who are the people?
The Lombards?
Yeah, the Lombards.
No, this was his conversation with them. Said, I don't mean to be rude, dude. Is that what he said?
You know, there's some embellishments in there vocally that I'm not sure what he says, but I get the basics of it. Yeah, I don't mean to be rude, but you better change your attitude.
Let me make it nice and clear, dear. I don't mean to be rude, dude. It's written by a Ninja Turtle.
The line before it
Michelangelo
was...
Michelangelo and Gary.
Who's the fifth Ninja Turtle. Yeah.
Then there's the line before it, the exit's right there.
Mm-hmm.
I'm not sure if that's just what do they call that, a preemptive strike?
Yeah.
Knowing that they'd be an opening band and might not be well-received, yeah. Who knows?
Mm. There's an overall jaded quality to this song.
And he's got kind of that sneering, the inflections of the lyrics. He's just, you know, kind of a defiant, bratty, sneering quality to it. I wouldn't say punk rock because this doesn't resemble punk rock at all, but it's just got, you know, there's plenty of attitude there. Mm-hmm. Which matches the lyrics.
Now was that Nuno? I wasn't sure because the voice always sounds different during that little pre-chorus, those couple lines there.
It could be.
I don't know. No. It's just I never
noticed it before.
I always kind of thought like that doesn't sound like Sharon. In other parts of the song, at least. I could be wrong there.
I don't know. It could be. Maybe someone who knows better than us will let us know.
Oh, probably a lot of people.
Yeah.
But it always sounded to me like it was a little bit different, a little bit different timbre in the voice, if you will.
No rotten apple's going to spoil my funk. That's what he said in there.
You're all invited to the party. You don't even have to come.
Yeah.
You know, it reminds me of a song title that I had at one point. It's Everyone's Outside Smoking. It's a very cynical look at performing in front of people.
Because your friends come to the show and then don't even watch you.
And they're just hanging outside while you're playing.
Yeah, yeah. You begged people to show up for weeks and then they just... they're so put out by having to come to your show that they just stand outside. It's the worst.
Yeah. So yeah. I can identify with this sentiment quite a bit.
Yeah.
Been there.
There's something to that. That's what's deterred me from even attempting to be in a band again since 2000. I was 23 the last time I was in a band. That's when I had enough asking people to come.
Yeah. There's a list of deal breakers. That one's at the top.
It's
Yeah, I did it up through about the age of 30, and even that was way too old.
Yeah, it's bothering. Now, if people come to your shows, that's a different story. If you got people who just want to see you, hey, God bless. But what I'm saying when you
have to go to your mailing list,
and you have to guilt trip your friends and family and inconvenience them to come to your show.
Doing that hustle it's just, you know.
Wear you down.
That's when I see people my age still doing it, it's just Not for me. Definitely not for me. This outlet for my creativity is much more my speed these days.
Yeah. You don't like what you see here. Get the fuck out. We won't try to force feed you. Get the fuck out.
My goodness. What did they say?
This is one of those cheeky, I just want to fuh songs.
Yep.
There's a whole bunch of them. I'm sure we can go down the list and figure out more of them. There was a period where there were a few, I don't know, in like the mid to late 2000s where it's that intentional.
Yeah, and you could almost swear that they are just saying, they're not saying funk.
Yeah.
If there was an interview where they said, we didn't even say that.
Yeah.
Just every voice on there, none of them say that, actually. Yeah,
we actually gave the finger to the microphone while we were saying it.
Yeah, but, we called it that. And it's, what was, I've seen it a few times. There are those, YouTube videos where it'll be, the same exact verbal sound clip.
Oh,
it'll have different words on the bottom, and you can hear every single one of them.
Yeah,
this could be something like that. Just the power of suggestion, like that.
That could be,
and then it makes you hear it.
That could be it.
It's entirely possible. This is an obscene song.
And then also, you just would assume in a live setting, you just say it the other way, right? It doesn't have to be censored for radio or for broadcast or whatever.
Right.
Yeah. All right, let's keep going.
Sorry. Can you back it up a few seconds? He just the bass player got his name dropped there.
Did I say hey Patrick?
Hey Patrick. All right. I'm not sure. I know he said
not bad for a bass player.
He said not bad for a pasty-faced white boy.
Oh, okay.
Yep. Never knew that's what he said.
Yep. He's letting Patrick have it.
I tell you, Sharon's a wild guy on the microphone sometimes.
Yeah.
I enjoy it.
Sharon,
he's uninhibited.
Interesting guy, right?
Yeah, an uninhibited guy behind the microphone.
He knows how to work a crowd, work a stage. Mm-hmm. He's a front man. He's an entertainer.
Yeah. Can't please everybody, but everybody cannot please me. I don't like what I see. That's why I do what I want to. So why don't you do? I do it to me. Hey. And it's
like, I know with this new song that came out, this Extreme song, that it's a big Eddie Van Halen homage, or at least that's what I've heard.
Okay.
That there's some playing in there that's the idea. Very much, I'm hearing a lot of influence from Eddie Van Halen in the fact that you've got the rhythm guitar essentially playing what sounds like it could be leads the entire time,
right?
But it is the rhythm.
Yeah.
And it's very complementary to the vocals as well.
Mm-hmm.
It's not
like an interplay with what's going on.
It's not like I'm just going to hit some chords and then switch it when the melody needs it. It's very much its own thing, and it works in conjunction with the vocals very well.
You get the impression that these guys spent a lot of time rehearsing together.
Oh yeah.
I don't think you could just do what either of those two guys is doing without doing this song 1,000 times. And
and the drums and bass are just, they're not doing anything complicated, but
they're solid.
But they're perfectly solid. Yeah. They're doing exactly what needs to be done.
Yeah.
Yeah, you can't have everybody being all busy and virtuoso. It doesn't end well. It becomes a mess, and something's got to give, and it depends. Whoever in the band is the virtuoso, in this case, obviously it's Nuno. You want to just and that's another resemblance to Van Halen, although Alex Van Halen was definitely a busier, you know, sort of flashier drummer, but then you had the just the basic bass playing, which is all you need, which, you know, people erroneously look at that and say, well, he was no good, he can be, he can replace him with anybody, blah blah blah, and none of that is true. Just because somebody plays things in a basic way doesn't mean they're not a top shelf musician.
Yeah.
And part of being a top shelf musician is knowing your role and blending in with other top shelf musicians like this. So,
And I think one of the things I've liked most about Extreme over the years is that the tempo of the recordings are just slightly faster in most cases than you would if someone had this song. And a lot of times I think it would come out a little bit slower. They have it where, you know, because we've done a lot of Kiss songs, and some of the early albums, it's just very, it's too slow.
It drags a little
bit. The energy's not there.
Yeah.
But Extreme's a band where I think it's like the perfect, they picked perfect tempos for the recordings of their songs. Like, it's always lively. It's not too fast, but it never drags.
Which is hard to do. Because,
I would think so.
Well, I felt like, you know, from band, I mean, I didn't play the drums. You were the one, when you played drums, you would be setting the tempo. But I just think, like, if you have some kind of adrenaline pumping, you don't really know how fast or slow you're playing. You know what I mean?
Yeah, and there's fluctuation and all that.
Yeah, because you get that thing where, like, maybe this is going back to our runner's high discussion, but, like, I would get this with exercising, with music on, where if you get to a certain point, songs you're familiar with sound slower than normal. And I felt like that would happen sometimes performing too, where there's like, you have some kind of adrenaline high and you're like, what the hell? Everything's dragging because you want to go faster, but everything else is dragging.
Yeah. And I think there's also when you're the performer and you played the song many times and you know it so well, you can just kind of like, you hear a lot of earlier recordings, like a lot of the old, you know, like metal bands, hard rock bands, they're flying through their material. Like, you listen to an old Maiden recording when Deano was in it.
They're fast as hell.
Yeah. And it's like, is it because this is their material and this makes it exciting for them to play it faster?
No, they're probably high too.
Well, maybe that too.
Clive Burr.
Well, yeah, probably. But it might be a thing where you're not taking into account that the audience is hearing it for the first time.
Yeah.
You're kind of like, okay, we need to keep this fresh and exciting for us. So, and it's coming out faster.
Yeah.
We want to kind of blaze through this.
You got to have a barometer on that. Someone has to be in charge of keeping you under control before it turns into a mess.
I mean, you know, the Stones live albums were always like, not so much get your ya-ya's out, but stuff that came out afterwards. The one Tattoo You tour, I think it's called Still Life or something. Tempos are like twice as fast as they are on the album. Just unlistenable to me. But, you know, there's many explanations for that. But the other thing, looping back around to what we're listening to here is, and we've talked about this before on the show, is that it's easy to get intimidated in the studio, especially if you're a young band and, you know, time is money in the studio. And when you're on a major label, there's pressure to get shit done and get shit done the right way. And that causes a lot of, you know, can suck the energy out of a project and make people be like, okay, we're going to do this a little more slow and deliberate to make sure we get it right.
Yeah.
And you don't hear any of that on here. I mean, these guys don't sound intimidated by the studio setting whatsoever. And it's only their second major release. So that says a lot for their confidence and their, you know, professionalism.
A Love how it changes to that disco beat, by the way. That in 1990, there was a major major artist going to a disco beat like that during a chorus.
Yeah.
With the horns and everything. It's great.
Yeah.
You gotta love how eclectic these guys were.
What was this kind of the end of Extreme?
No, they had the three sides to every story. Yeah. It was a three-sided album that came out next.
Was that big? Because, I mean, I know this is the one with More Than Words.
I remember Rest in Peace having a lot of airplay.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, after More Than Words, there was a lot of anticipation. But, again, I think the timing of it was when everything was shifting. So,
yeah.
And to come out with a triple album, basically, was pretty ambitious. And so I think, I think after the third one is when, you know, just this type of music in general just kind of got pushed to the back burner. But no, I think they were still on the way up after this one.
It's like the Chili Peppers on steroids, like really. I mean, it's
Subway to Venus, kind of.
But it's like the Chili Peppers, even more so. It's like pumped up, louder, mm-hmm. played even better.
Mm. Careful who you upset.
Just getting those last few people I didn't last week. Yeah, I guess the Chili Peppers we didn't bring up at all yet, but I would assume there's some sort of influence there.
Yeah, for sure.
In less of a punk style.
Yeah.
More of a...
like rock, I don't know, hard rock.
Just more of like a musician style, you know? Yeah, like Chris said, these guys were all over at Guitar Center. I would imagine every Guitar Center in the world was Extreme territory.
Oh yeah,
This is a Guitar Center band.
Yeah,
yeah, they definitely are. You know, even the didn't matter what instrument you played, you were probably into these guys if you were hanging out at Guitar Centers, because people who typically did that were the types who were like trying to impress people with their musicianship, noodling around, you know, on the guitar floor down in the drum department or something like that. But you know, if you listen to Mother's Milk, though, the way that album is produced, how big the drums sound, there's a lot of delay on the guitars. That's a big production. I miss that's become, I mean, Blood Sugar Sex Magik is a masterpiece. I will always believe that. I thought it was from the first time I listened to it.
Mm-hmm.
But Mother's Milk is still my favorite Chili Peppers album, just because there's a lot more energy. There's just it's not as self-indulgent. It's not as, you know, pretentious. And there's some big drumming and guitar playing going on that album, like big hard rock of the time stuff. I mean, it was still different California punk rock, all that other stuff, but there was a lot of big arena rock elements to that album that I have always appreciated.
Mm. Yep.
Do they even play anything from that anymore? One of the kids used to hang out at the cafe was a Groovatron fan. He plays drums in that Red Knot Chili Peppers tribute band that tours all over the country, and he was playing packed houses everywhere. I mean, follow him on social media. And he private messaged me, direct messaged me a few months ago when they were coming through, like playing at Hobart. He's like, "Yeah, you gonna come out to the show?" And I go, "I'll only come if you play Sexy Mexican Maid." And his response was, we don't play anything before Blood Sugar Sex Magic.
Did you say so. Chris L. has left the chat?
Pretty much. Yeah. You have been blocked by Chris L.
So,
but.
I'm looking at, because it's been a while since I've listened to Mother's Milk, but I mean Higher Ground is on it. They don't play Higher Ground?
I did.
Well, I don't think you could say the Chili Peppers play or don't play anything. I think they're very much, as far as I know, one show to the next. I don't think they have like a tight set list that they're doing on a tour. I think they're all over the place. But I think this last tour was very new, double album heavy.
Yeah.
But I don't think they play the same. They're one of those bands that could pull out something.
Yeah, but
from
do
any
they
era.
Bust out Subway to Venus anymore? I don't think so.
I don't think so.
It would have to be, you know, Higher Ground and that's it. I mean, what else are they going to play? I mean,
they probably do Stone Cold Bush once in a while.
Once in a blue moon.
I would be blown away to hear that.
Think so?
I mean, in a good way, too. Because, I mean, like I said, that album has just so much energy that kind of went away a little bit with the Rubin influence and all that stuff and everything else that happened. But, you know, this what we're listening to here, the Extreme, it's not that dissimilar to me from Mother's Milk era. Chili Peppers. I mean, they both sound like big arena rock to me, which I like.
Guy's massive.
Yeah,
just it one of those players that every note that he plays it makes sense, but it's also at somewhat unexpected. Well, maybe not every note, but he'll bust that out in every solo. It's, you know, he started kind of doing like almost like an Ace Frehley, just kind of bends, you know, at the beginning, and then it turned into a more of an 80s shred thing, had some tapping going on, just lightning fast.
He can do whatever the hell he wants.
Stuff. Yeah, and it all flows very nicely, and it sounds great. Everything's crystal clear. He's one of those players where everything is perfectly on time if he wants it to be. It lags a little bit when he wants to put a little attitude in like that, and you can hear every single note perfectly. He's hitting everything.
He's
one of those guys.
he's easily, in my estimation, on the level of the Vies and the Yngwies of the world. Just complete command of the instrument. You listen, and you're just like, this guy could do anything he wants to do on the guitar and make it look totally effortless. And he's in the very top echelon of guitar players in terms of having a complete command of the instrument, in my estimation. And typically he doesn't get named among those guys just because he plays a different style. But I would, you know, I would definitely put him shoulder to shoulder with Vai and Yngwie.
Yeah. Hard to disagree. The other guys are, they do more of like a solo show where they put the spotlight on themselves. So maybe that's the difference.
Maybe. I mean, Yngwie is the Viking, neoclassical shredder. And then Vai is just from another planet entirely. Mm-hmm. You know, Nuno plays the most accessible music of those three, I think, to mass audience. But, you know, and I think when you do that, sometimes the musicianship can be downgraded without merit by people. But I mean, he is absolutely top level in any category of guitar playing.
So chaotic with Sharon right now. I just imagine him in the studio.
It's losing it.
Just and this is like cardio. Like he's not stopping at all.
No, he's not.
And it doesn't matter. Like he's obscuring a lot of what's going on musically. It's just it's become a bit I won't say muddled, but very congested and just frantic, I'll just say.
Yeah, that's funny, because now that you said it, I kind of do see Gary Sharon as the Richard Simmons of rock music.
Well, he still is, 35 years later. That's the other thing with him and Nuno. These guys haven't fucking aged.
No. Yeah.
I mean, literally. It's how does that happen? Clean living, whatever their secret is, genetics, I don't know, but they literally don't look like they've aged a day since the late 80s.
I don't know how they're pulling it off.
They're doing it.
They're doing it. Someone is. All right, let's finish up here.
There you go.
Explosion at the end.
Motley Crue-esque explosion at the end. I've forgotten it was there.
Yeah.
It's a nice touch.
It's the only appropriate ending after all that.
You would think, yeah.
Gary.
In fact, they
explodes.
Probably it wasn't even intentional. It's like one of the mics blew up at the end of the session and they just kept it.
Yeah.
Who produced this album? Let me look this up.
I don't know, but it is time for us to vote Sweet Surrender or Kick in the Crotch. I chose this song from our buddy Jeremy on the list. I will vote first, and I'm going to give it a Sweet Surrender.
It's Sweet Surrender. Hell yes.
A lot of the things that Nick said are what stand out to me. I know this song. I've heard it many times, but sitting here and listening to it together with Nick's commentary really elevated it. Nick, you should be on the payroll with Extreme. Just talking about the tempos and the energy level. But yeah, that takes it to the next level. It's not easy to do what they did here. And it's essentially, it's a dance song, you know? It's a dance number with a lot going on top of it. But cool song, fun song, tons of energy. They're leaving you wanting nothing at the end of the song.
Yeah, and co-produced with Nuno Bettencourt was Michael Wagner, and here are some of his credits: Balls to the Wall, Except. It was a mixer, which we've talked about. It sounded great. Mm-hmm. We've got Constrictor and Raise Your Fist and Yell by Alice Cooper. Those are good. Three Dokken albums, one of them under lock and key, which is one of the pinnacle of 80s hard rock guitar sounds to me. Keel, the self-titled debut from Keel.
Can't win them all.
So Far So Good So What, he was a mixer on that. Too Fast for Love, he was on that. No More Tears, Ozzy.
Wow.
Great sounding album.
That's a big one. Yeah.
Yeah. Slave to the Grind, Skid Row, first one. Album. Geez. Oh, what's the other one? Yeah, at the end, my favorite X album, which is their most commercial sounding, Ain't Love Grand, he produced that. That's one of my all-time favorite albums.
Wow.
Do you guys like X at all? Are you familiar with them?
I know some of their stuff. I do like them. I like, what's that guy's name, Billy Zoom?
Billy Zoom on Billy guitar. Zoom. John Doe on the bass and the vocals. DJ Bonebreak on drums, I believe.
That's his name? Okay.
And then, of course, XC and Cervenka. But yeah. Ain't Love Grand is like their attempt to go full-on commercial. Mm-hmm. I love it. It sounds great. The songs are great. That's the thing. It's like when these quote-unquote alternative bands get lambasted for selling out. It's just like, so what's the crime in making a good-sounding album with good songs on it? Why is that a fucking...
That's the
goal. Why should you be insulted for that?
That's the goal.
It's like the L7 album, Bricks Are Heavy. Same thing. All their other stuff is just real hardcore, aggressive, abrasive stuff, and then they come out with this hugely commercial sounding album, and I love it. It sounds great.
Well, is the offensive part of it the fact that it sounds like other bands that didn't have whatever edge or cool factor to them? Is that the why people are offended?
I can only see that if it sounded totally different from what you were doing before, and it sort of sounds like, okay, you're doing this. You're compromising your artistry at this point because you're trying to sound like whatever is successful. Now, that I could see people having a gripe with, but I don't know if that's the case. No, I don't think so.
It's just like this is a more refined, professional version of what we were doing before.
Well, that's great. I mean, that's what I think. That's why you keep trying, right?
Yeah. Well, not everybody wants to do that, but the bands that do want to do that and do it well, they shouldn't be criticized for it, you know? But then, you're selling out, blah, blah, blah. It's like, yeah, I got to keep the fucking lights on around here, man, you know?
Well, I mean, but honestly, it's probably pretty rare that someone starts playing music without the goal of like, wow, what if we can participate in the making of an album like this one that we're listening to right now that we love.
Yeah.
I mean, that's got to be a huge percentage.
You would think.
That's something unattainable for just about everybody who tries it.
Yeah. Well, and that's just, that goes to, you bring up Nevermind by Nirvana, okay? You're recording for Geffen. You clearly have the intent of recording the biggest, best-sounding album you can possibly make. There's no shame in that. They came out with one of the most influential albums of all time.
Yep.
So, but yeah, it's, long story short, decorated producer produced some of the great, best-sounding harder rock bands or harder rock albums of all time, and this is on the list.
And I was looking up the horn section.
Mm-hmm.
Only one guy. Obviously, I don't have enough time to research everybody here, but there's one guy who does have his own Wikipedia page, and that's Dick Slide Hyde on bass trombone. Yeah, every time you hear a horn section in a song like this, you're going to see, oh, he played with Count Basie, Herbie Hancock, Frank Sinatra, Jaco Pastorius, Steely Dan, Earth, Wind, and Fire, Beach Boys.
So everyone, every horn you've ever heard in your life.
Every bass
is Dick Slide.
Trombone is Dick Slide Hyde. I mean, it's one of those where this is the guy who's on everything.
Yep. There you go. I had no idea.
Yeah.
All right. Who wants to vote next?
I'll go next. A big Sweet Surrender. Come on now.
It's Sweet Surrender. Hell yes.
I haven't listened to Extreme for a while. I'll be maybe unpopular here, but that's okay because I'm not selling out. I'm not a huge fan of Rise, the new one.
I'm not either.
I hate the chorus.
Is it? What was the chorus? It's like a oh, whoa, whoa.
I really, really hate what they did with the chorus. I'm sorry. And that's not trying to take away from, how great this band is or anything, and still is, I'm sure. But I haven't listened to them for a while, And I used to pretty regularly. I had like a mix CD that I made of, you know, my favorite songs by them. Makes me want to get a playlist going, you know, in the next couple of days. We're talking about Rest in Peace. What an incredible, great song that is.
Okay.
I feel like Decadence Dance.
Yeah. A lot of them off of this album. Money is a great one.
Yeah. I mean, they're another band that wasn't... Was Porno Graffiti, it wasn't a double album, was it? It was just a single one, but the next album, of course, was had the three, you know, the triple album, and then Waiting for the Punchline, I think, was a single album. But, you know, they've put out a lot of material. They got a lot of deep cuts, and most of it is pretty top shelf.
It is a single album. 13 song. I had Wholehearted on this too.
Wholehearted. Oh, that's one of the, honestly, as far as a rock band doing an acoustic song, that's up near, that's at the top.
I would agree.
I mean, what a great song that is. And I mean, He-Man Woman Haters on here, Susie's right on here.
Yeah. I mean, they put out a lot of stuff, a lot of good stuff.
All right. So, Chris,
Sweet Surrender, of course.
It's Sweet Surrender. Hell yes.
I mean, you know, for the obvious reasons we've talked about, the musicianship, the production, the style of it, but also just fond memories of those early days at the Chicago Guitar Center, first arriving in Chicago and pursuing my own musical dreams, and just that time of my life was so great, and this was a big part of the soundtrack to it. So
Chris was chasing that neon rainbow.
I was
living that honky-tonk dream.
It was good times, man. It was a good time to be in a band in Chicago. It's when everything was blowing up. So
I'm trying to figure out what song Nick is quoting over there.
That's an old country song.
Is it? Okay.
Yeah.
All right. Well,
all right, Hammond, I got a question for you.
Paul Stanley needs to know. He's gotta know.
Oh, this had to be a band that Kiss was like paying attention to.
Yeah, like, hey, what's going on here?
When they came out on the scene, can we incorporate some of this? I would imagine that happened.
Yeah.
Well, I mean, and Revenge, it's not funky, but as far as the amount of time that they obviously put into it and how great it sounds and how great the songs are and how, you know, it's very well produced. And yeah, and like I was saying about Extreme, it's an album that does not lack energy due to like tempo issues.
True. Very true.
So who knows?
Yeah.
You got all these young hotshots coming out, playing up a storm.
Uh-huh.
Gotta keep
it's
up.
It's gotta scare you when you're however old. They would be approaching 40 at that point and thinking, uh-oh. Are we done? Are we toast? Paul Stanley's gotta know.
He's gotta know.
Is Get the Funk Out a rock and roll boner classic? As voted by the three rock and roll boners in this room. See if we can make Nick's Gucci boss stand up. Oh, yeah. Let's see.
Who wants to go first? I'll go first.
Okay.
How about me, Chris, Andy? Andy's the one who picked it. He should be the one who, if it gets to him, will make the final choice.
Me?
Yeah.
Okay.
So me, Chris, you.
So would this be Riding the Eagle Backwards in the old days?
It is.
Yes.
Pot of Thunder month. Some throwbacks. Rock.
Roll.
Boomer.
Like Andy said, this is a song where by the end of it, you get the feeling these guys left it all there.
Yeah.
Oh, yeah. Like I said, there was no lack of energy in the studio. They didn't hold anything back, like you said. These guys completely comfortable in that element, and you know, known to be a live band, but not because their studio albums were lacking. They were just so good on stage. I mean, yeah, the energy is palpable on pretty much everything they've released. I mean, you can't accuse them of you know, not rising to the occasion in the studio.
Well, there you go. If you disagree with us, we're sorry.
That's just the fucking way it is.
It's a rock and roll boner.
Look at that.
All right, let's take a quick commercial break, and we'll be right back with Nick's favorite part of the show.
I don't even remember.
It's called the Yardo Questions, and it starts in a moment.
Don't get yards of questions,
motherfucker. I give them.
Sing away.
Yes, chief.
Yes.
The lightning round.
Look where we found ourselves. It's time for another Yardo Questions. I think people have me figured out.
Good.
They finally hacked the system. They know that if Chris posts something about how we're recording today, that's when to submit
like
the
that.
Yardo Questions.
Fresh out of the oven.
Yep.
Of course, it's another thing where, you know, we want to be cognizant of, you know, one or two jagoffs dominating and monopolizing things. But, you know, at the end of the day, I like the, you know, the real-time aspect of it.
Mm-hmm. Keeping it fresh, this week's Yardo Questions comes to us from Will S., What's up, Will S.?
Hey, Will.
Love the show. Love the Patreon. You know the drill. Here's a yard. Ooh. Look at him getting right to business.
Look at that.
Compliments.
Look at that. Yeah.
Thank you, Will.
Yes.
All right. Question one. Ooh, it's aimed just at Chris.
Oh,
this is
going
to be fun. Here we go. Chris, I'm asking as someone close to you in age, whose landlord is currently being investigated by government authorities. No joke, shit's wild. If you have any entertaining, in hindsight of course, horror stories about living conditions, rentals in your younger years, during your band days, etc. Back when I was briefly in a band, I spent my share of nights sleeping on wood floors of condemned apartments. God, we were broke. I don't miss that.
No.
How about you?
College flop house that we lived in off campus, there were five of us living there. What a dump. And the landlord was just a piece of work. I mean, I sat there and watched him pay off a city inspector who was going through the house because the fucking bathtub was about to fall through the floor. It was just rotted out around the bottom of the bathtub. It's amazing it didn't come crashing through the floor into the basement below. And but he eventually had to replace that because somebody literally could have been killed. It was something that was on the verge of just completely falling apart. So it was the only bathroom in the house. So while he did what he had to do in there, he built this cinder block shower in the basement next to the washer and dryer that literally looked like something out of a concentration camp. Wow. Or a prison.
Wow.
And we did what we had to do until the bathroom was fixed, but yeah, it was horrific. We ended up turning it into a marijuana grow room area. It ended up being perfect for that. You just had the light rigged up the top and the plants could just go grow straight up, and it worked out great for them.
And this shower area?
Yeah.
Yeah.
So you could water the plants right there, just turn on the shower. Ended up being great for that. But for like a month we all had to shower in this thing, and it was, you know, it was, I imagine it's what would have been like being in prison.
Did it have hot and cold?
Yeah, I mean, okay. It had that going for it, yeah, but it was a real, you know, it was a nightmare and a real shithole, but we enjoyed it.
Yeah. I'm sure you guys were very respectful of the property, too.
We were not. We actually had covered the walls of the basement were covered in magic marker graffiti for the whole. We lived there for 3 years and just, you know, security deposit be damned. We just broke graffiti all over the walls and left it that way when we left.
Yeah.
Huge bonfires in the backyard. By the time we were done, there was just a crater in the middle of the backyard of where we would burn things and do all sorts of mayhem. Just at crazy keg parties over there. Just absolute mayhem. You guys never did that sort of thing, huh? Like renting a shithole.
No, we're gentlemen.
Yeah, I gotta agree with Will. You didn't miss much. I mean, there's no. It's kind of fun while you're doing it, but looking back on it, it's kind of shocking the conditions we allowed ourselves to live in willingly.
Yeah, I don't know how I would have held up in a situation like that, because even back then at that age, I was a bit of like a tidy boy. Not saying that I never had a mess, but I could not have lived in a filthy place with friends, you know, that are throwing garbage on the floor, and I'd be the one vacuuming, angry at everyone. So
yeah, it was that's how it was back in those days.
Yeah. All right, question two. Ooh, this one's for Nick. Nick, who do you think was the sleaziest old-time radio character? I nominate Johnny Dollar for his crippling insecurity. I remember an episode where some secretary mentioned working for him, and he interrupted her with, "Working for just anybody?" or something. She rephrased her statement to flatter her boss. Still makes me laugh.
Yours truly, Johnny Dollar?
I don't know. Who's Johnny Dollar? What's his deal?
I like the name. I've never heard of that guy.
Just, I've listened to it. I've heard that one. It's not one I've listened to, like, the whole series, but it, just like a private eye kind of a guy, like a Philip Marlowe, I think, kind of a character. The sleaziest. That's a good question. Well, I'm sure in real life a lot of them were. all the old vaudeville performers.
Yeah.
It's unfortunately tales of sleaze. As long as the day is long, basically.
And you know that hasn't changed. That's just
people
in that position. They either that's what they want, and they go that path to get it, or once they get in that spotlight, they're offered that and they take it.
And
one or the other.
And you know what? I don't know a whole lot about what went down with R. Kelly, but it seems to be a logical extension of that sort of mentality.
Sure.
That something could get away from someone and get out of
control. Yeah, where you somehow convince yourself that this is okay because of who you are or whatever. Over the 30-year career that it escalated to that.
Sure.
Not saying it was, but I'm saying maybe in his mind. He got away with stuff his whole life. Why would anything ever catch up with him?
It's entirely possible that it was just part of when you make it.
Yeah.
That's what you can do now.
Yeah.
I don't know, but to answer the question, I can't really think of one that's like particularly sleazy, so I'll just say one of my favorite ones, that he's a bit of a rascal, not a total sleaze. He's a reformed crook who is always on the run from the cops. They always think he did it. Of course, he never did. He always solves it for him. That's Boston Blackie.
There's a restaurant near Playboy headquarters, Boston Blackie's.
Yeah, it was a radio show and then a TV show. Just in the interest of time, because I can't think of anybody who's just, you know, pure sleaze or anything. I'll just go with a
Boston Blackie.
A bit of a fun rascal who's always at odds, with the law, never actually having done anything.
But at some point he did. If
he was a reformed crook, but in the episodes he's
at that point in life it was in his past.
He's always being accused, and he always gets away, and gives the cops a hard time.
All right, and question three is for me. Says, Andy, since you've mentioned liking stand-up comedy, why do you think so many killer comedians come from your / the general Chicago area? My favorite comedian's Kyle Kinane, and he's from Addison, Illinois. I don't know where that is, but everyone I've met from Chicago has been hilarious. What gives? Huh.
Well, can I step in
here?
Sure,
sure.
I think the obvious answer at the surface is this: where Second City is.
Yeah.
I mean, it's like a mecca for comedians to come here and be accepted into that comedy troupe, right?
Yeah.
That's usually like for the sketch comedians, you hear that a lot of, like, the Second City. But for, like, the stand-ups, it's always like, Catch a Rising Star, or the Comedy Store.
I would say, like, New York seems to be, though, like he said, he loves Kyle Kinane, he's from here, but I feel like East Coast would be more stand-up stars over time.
Yeah, that's true.
Or the Comedy Store, you know, on the West Coast and stuff like that. But you don't, at least from what I've listened to of, like, interviews with comedians, you don't hear too much about them saying, like, oh, there's this great club in Chicago or something like that.
No, there's Zanies.
Yeah, I mean, there are clubs.
There is, but it's not a place that you hear people romanticize about the old days.
Well,
it's not the scene of where you hone your craft. It's more of a stop on a tour, or you do a weekend in Chicago.
It's not like jazz music where Chicago is the place where people come up.
But it is for improv, absolutely.
Yeah,
just
definitely.
With stand-up, not as much. And there are more clubs, I think, than there used to be, but you could do open mics. I just don't think you would get the same experience as if you did it on the East or West Coast.
Well, but as we know, comedy is the hardest entertainment medium by a long shot to pull off and be successful.
Yeah, I mean, it's such an odd thing to walk into a room of strangers. At least, I guess you have the benefit of the doubt that they're trying to find humor in what you're doing.
I guess so.
But yeah, it's not easy to be able to flip a room of people and start making them involuntarily bark at you, you know?
Yeah, and I mean, you know, musicians, they can be in cover bands. There are no cover comedians.
No,
there's no Andrew Dice Clay tribute comedian. Nobody's going to see that, you know?
Yeah, disgusting would that
there
be?
There was an interesting thing I saw a couple years ago. It was a Mitch Hedberg tribute thing where some guy was, like, doing it as, like, Mitch Hedberg. I think it was, like, him from the grave, basically. And the jokes were actually, like, they were original jokes, but they were done in the style of Mitch Hedberg. So it was weird, but it actually came off well, and I can't remember the guy's name.
I'll say, if you do it one time for some weird thing, okay. But if that's your touring act, no good.
But it is interesting, though, that they don't have that.
I'm thankful they don't. And also, even established comedians can't do hits.
They can't do hits.
When you're done with...
I mean, they do.
Well, I mean, like, John Witherspoon walks on stage and says, bang, 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 up a dog's ass.
Well, he's gonna.
You know.
No, but I mean, there are comedians, I think, who do that. They'll go into a routine that people know.
I think very few.
Yeah,
but they can't rely on it, you know.
And I would say it's on a smaller percentage is going to go into material you've heard before. For the most part, it's once they've done it, once they've recorded it for something that's been released, it's done.
Yeah.
You know, if it's on some special, they're not going back to it, and they got to start over. So, you know, you can't be, you know, the Rolling Stones playing your hits over your career.
Right. Exactly.
You've got whatever come up with in the last few months, and that's it.
You have to be constantly coming out with new original material. That is fucking as hard as it gets.
Yeah.
You know, it's not. Movies are just going to make another Marvel movie about Spider-Man and Batman again. How often do they go to? They just keep going back to that. Well, you can't do that in comedy.
No, you can't.
I'm telling you, I don't think this is anything that people don't already know, but it deserves to be said because comedians deserve all the respect because that is far and away the hardest entertainment medium to to get any traction, much less even a small amount of success.
Yeah.
You know, you got to be on top of it, man. And yeah. to be funny constantly.
Yeah.
You know, music, you got your serious songs, your fun songs, blah, blah, blah. You mix it up. You can't, like, get morose in comedy for a prolonged length of time.
That's when it becomes a one-man show.
Right. Yeah. And that's it's not comedy anymore. It's performance art.
Yeah.
So, Andy, how many minutes do you have? A real a comedy question
I think
you.
It was three.
Yeah.
Well, I did my 1 3-minute open mic night at the Laugh Factory, so I think that was it. I don't know. In my mind, I thought, oh, maybe this is something I should go into. And even at that point when I did it, that was late.
That's great that you did it,
many years after.
Well, you're not Rodney Dangerfield or anything.
That's true. Because he was, what, in his 40s?
Yeah, and he's one of the all-time greats. So.
Yeah, that's true.
Last summer, I was sick, feverish, and all that.
Yeah.
That weakened state.
Yeah.
I have a note on my phone. I have my stand-up routine notes. I've got a couple of bits that I thought, hey, man.
Hey, why not? I can do that.
During a fever dream, I thought, that's kind of funny. That's a funny idea.
I've thought about that, too, like putting together bits. But to have the balls to actually go up there in front of an audience and do that and deliver it with a rhythm and a cadence and stuff, that is so fucking hard. It's not even...
That's the part that didn't bother me.
Really?
I'm not saying I did it good, but it didn't bother me to go do it and try to, you know, present it in a certain way. I was just trying to relate to the people. That was more of a problem.
Yeah, as far work as my in the thought, room and adjusting, you know, on the fly. Yeah. That's another element that, you know, is something you should be able to do.
Andy had a great opening that the crowd just was not...
I should have been carried out on a chair. It was and celebrated.
It was
the
it was the crowd's fault. This could have been a Bill Burr Philadelphia situation where it was the crowd's fault.
It was,
but that's Andy the thing. Didn't go it's that like route. You go up there on stage, you're feeling great about your opening material, and it gets nothing.
Yeah.
It's like it's like going in the prize fighting rig and getting decked in the first 10 seconds. It's like, how the fuck am I? How do I right the ship here?
Yeah.
What do I do? You know?
Yeah. That's the hard part right there, because you don't know what you're getting into. I guess unless you. If you get to a point where you're established, then you know who's at your shows. But if you're if you're unknown, you got no idea what the crowd's going to be like, who it's made up of, how you need to pivot to.
Yeah, as a first timer, you probably just have to be goofy. You've got to be like a goofy, lovable kind of a character.
So just people want to like you.
Not feel bad, but they're just like, hey, this guy's a good time. I don't have to. Well, I don't have to worry about laughing and think. Can I laugh at this? Like your opening joke? I have a feeling people were looking around like nobody else is laughing. I probably shouldn't either.
They're looking for the security guard.
Yeah, and it's also, you know, in that respect, the comedian and the musician are the same because, like, we'll say the musician playing their original material, it's like to get somebody who doesn't necessarily know what you're about to like your stuff the first time they hear it is a lot to ask. But as a musician, you can abandon that anytime you want and play fucking U2 covers and get gigs and people will respond to it. But it's not your music.
Yeah.
Like going back to the Red Hot Chili Peppers tribute band. I mean, they're touring all over. I think they got flown out to, like, they played in Dubai. Somebody hired them in Dubai, and they went and played there. I mean, it's crazy.
That's insane.
But it's not your music, though.
I couldn't do it.
I couldn't do it either. I understand that saying that makes it sound like I'm not trying to be superior to that. They're successful playing music for a living. You gotta love that. What I'm saying is, to loop back around, You can't do that as a comedian. You can't just be, I'm the Andrew Dice Clay tribute comedian, and I tour all over the country, and I get hired in Dubai, and I do exact Dice Clay sets from the 80s. That's not a thing.
No.
I bet it becomes a thing once, like, all your main comedians have died off years from now.
But a lot of them have already.
Well, but I mean, like, but a lot of them are still around.
But nobody's doing Lenny Bruce tribute acts in comedy because nobody's going to go pay for that.
Yeah.
I have a I'm going to predict years from now that will be a thing, though.
As society deteriorates, maybe that'll happen.
I mean, we had holograms. We had the Dio hologram.
I was just about to say,
for
the hologram, that's the perfect medium, is to do the stand-up comedian. Not the fucking Dio surrounded by, like, an actual band, but, like, you know, Lenny Bruce or, you know, any of the classic 60s or any of the classic comedians who have passed away, that would be the perfect thing for the hologram. Yeah. But then, you know, the comedians at state would have to run it. What I'm saying is, it goes back to, you can't do that as a human comedian. I'm going to do a comedy covers act. So my first joke is going to be by Steve Martin.
Yeah.
Then I'm going to segue into a joke by Dana Carvey. And then I'm going to do this. And it's like, no, you can't do that in comedy.
And I mean, if you do it well, it's really no different than being a cover band. But there's, I think, it's not socially acceptable.
No, I think you'd be...
That's the problem.
I think it's policed by other comedians.
I was going to say, you would not be allowed on the premises of the venues because that's just not how they operate. You got to come original or you're done. Isn't that what Carlos Mencia in? Wasn't he exposed for stealing people's material?
Yeah. And who knows? I don't even know how much... He might have had, 55 minutes of his own and 5 minutes stolen.
But that's all
enough.
It takes,
Yeah, but that's it. Is it any different than being in a cover band?
No,
but you can't. Besides the level of possible level of acceptance of that sort of thing.
It's vastly different because you can't just go up and I'm going to take that joke from the Bob Newhart album. I'm just going to go up and say it verbatim. Then I'm going to take the joke from the Steve Martin album and do that next.
Well,
and
it's like, but it's identical conceptually. It's just
conceptually,
you can't
it's the
do
same
it.
Thing. I guess you could probably get away with it if you did impressions. If you sounded just like Bob Newhart and you were doing the phone routine and everything like that. I think you could get away with it then if you were crediting the original source.
But I still don't think
there's a market for that. I don't think people
probably not
would
a
go
viable
and see
market,
it. And again, the venues,
you're gonna toss your ass out.
they're not gonna hire you because they have the same mindset. You got to come original or get the fuck out of here.
Yeah. Yeah, that's the truth.
It's just, it's so different, but it's just, anybody who's even attempted live comedy gets nothing but respect for me, because that is the hardest entertainment medium by a long shot, in my estimation.
So my answer to Will is, he said, why do you think so many funny people are from this area? I don't think that's true. I just think that, like Nick said, maybe you just hear about a lot of people coming here to be involved in Second City, so you got a lot of stories about people in their Chicago days, but maybe not from here. I don't know. I don't think anyone's funnier anywhere on the planet than anywhere else. You know, I think he's just had good luck, maybe.
Right, and you're either funny or you're not. It's just, you know.
But I don't think it's more concentrated here. I just think it is what it is, no matter where you are.
I don't think so either, but...
I think he's just had good luck, and also maybe, again, you get some... You hear stories about people coming to Chicago.
Well, it's a centrally located big city.
Yeah.
You know, and it's just... It's easier to get to for a lot more people than to go all the way to one coast or the other, and that could explain it.
Yeah.
All right, well, Will, thank you so much for your Yardo questions. And if you want to submit a Yardo questions, go to podofthunder.com, click that little widget, and submit not one, not two, but three questions. What's the thing on your left side that wiggles for no reason when you're talking? I don't know what that is. I think I just had some kind of major organ shut down on me mid-sentence.
Lower or upper sternum?
Is your appendix about to burst?
It might. It's been doing it for the past couple hours, but it just happened again while I was speaking.
Just a spasm?
It's like, whoa, 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 whoa.
That's weird.
That I don't know.
Yeah. That's probably because I'm drinking water and my body's saying, what is this?
Yeah.
This isn't Pepsi.
Yeah, that's not right.
What the hell? All right. Okay. Well, thank you, everybody, for listening. And we will be back next week with more Pot of Thunder. And I think I-